Tell me when you're ready.
Okay, when have you asked? I'm recording already.
This morning I'm talking to Claire Hart from the TIER Fund, New Zealand. And the TIER, or actually you're probably better to explain what the TIER Fund is and how it came to be.
Yeah, sure. Cool. So TIER Fund is an aid and development agency. So we, our goal is to alleviate poverty. So most of the work that we do is overseas. TIER Fund is part of, grew out of a TIER Fund in UK actually, in the UK, sorry, in about the 1960s.
Oh really?
Yeah, so I think that during that period of time there's a huge sort of influx of refugees around the world and sort of outflow of compassion towards those people. And so TIER Fund was originally the Evangelical Alliance Relief Fund, so out of the Evangelical Church, and now it's just sort of grown and around the world and developed into just TIER Fund.
And what prompted it to move into the assessment profession? What drove that?
Yeah, so we work in across five causes in New Zealand. So we have sponsor children, we work in what we call restore, which is responding to emergencies and disasters, empower, which is livelihoods development, so things like savings groups, that sort of thing. And Nourish, which is work, health, education, real basics, and finally in what we call Protect, which is anti-trafficking and exploitation. And so that's where ethical fashion is a great fit for us. So traditionally we've worked in the space of sexual exploitation, so women who've been trafficked into sexual exploitation, sort of preventing that happening, rescuing and rehabilitating. But as I think UN statistics show, there is a huge number of people who are in forced labour or other forms of labour exploitation. And so the Ethical Fashion Guide gives us a great way of sort of moving our work into that space and also engaging with New Zealand consumers, because, you know, we all need clothes. And so, you know, if we can help people to understand the linkages between their behaviour here, the type of clothes that they purchase, and what's happening further down the supply chains of those brands in terms of what workers are paid, sort of conditions they work in, and that sort of thing.
Yeah, it's amazing because you've been around, is it since 2013?
Yeah.
Is that right?
Yeah, so we partnered with Baptist World Aid and they started this in 2013 and we've been involved since about 2015.
Oh, right. Yeah. Well, it just amazes me how in such a short space of time it's become this really, really powerful assessment tool of brands that holds a huge amount of weight, and almost by default, if you don't participate, you're seen as being less than transparent, or that you've possibly got something to hide.
Yeah. I think when Baptist World Aid started doing this report, it was right after the Rana Plaza collapse, which sort of just catapulted the health and safety issues of the industry into the public spotlight. You know, people were horrified to see the images of the collapse of Rana Plaza, and it was the worst industry accident that's ever happened in the fashion industry or the garment industry. And so they sort of rode that wave of public awareness, which was excellent, which has sort of made it into, you know, the industry benchmark for research into the supply chains of fashion brands. And yes, you know, if a company doesn't engage with us, you do wonder, you know, what are they hiding? Because I think, you know, the global trend across the fashion industry and also other industries is towards transparency in your supply chains. And if you're not being transparent, well, what is the reason for that? Is it because you actually don't know what your supply chain is? You haven't traced it? You don't actually know where the product has been produced? Or is it because you do know and the business is being kept afloat through exploitation of some sort?
Right, so you want to keep that.
Yeah, that's right. There are invested interests in that, and we really just want to encourage brands towards transparency, whether that's through our report or on their own journey.
Your report comes out in April every year.
Yeah.
And from a business perspective, Henry, we watch it really keenly.
Yeah.
Who's in, who's not paying, and it looks like the number of brands engaging is growing hugely.
Yeah, overall we have about an 80% engagement rate with the brands, which is what we want, because we want to be able to work closely with them, because that gives us a bit more influence to help improve systems. I think the New Zealand space, though, actually has a lot of it might have a bit of a lower engagement rate, but I won't say too much about that until April.
Right, okay, well, stay tuned. So you're originally, the TIER Fund is really socially focused, and it's expanding more into an environmental focus, is that right?
Yeah, so historically we've looked at the labour rights space, in the exploitation of workers through low wages or poor conditions that they have to work in. But now we're introducing some questions on environmental management, because I think there is a slight difference between whether a brand is ethical and whether it's sustainable. And I think we're trying to sort of open that conversation. What's the difference between the two? Getting people to understand that, yep, even if a fast fashion brand does really well, pays their workers well, there's still a huge question about the sustainability of that brand and their environmental impact. So wanting to sort of dig deeper with brands in that space. And it's also in line with the fact that, you know, climate change is one of the hugest issues facing our generation, our world, and the fashion industry is a massive polluter.
Yeah. Have you seen the movie River Blue?
No.
Oh, that movie, it actually inspired me to stop dyeing my hair. Because it's about all the dye in these less regulated societies where clothing production takes place.
Yeah.
The amount of dye is going through their local water systems, and also the amount of chemicals, and so their shortened lifespans and
birth deformities and whatnot. Yeah, it's appalling. We don't often hear, like, suffer from the effects or even see the effects of, I guess, like, the finished product, right? But I think it's very naive to think that someone is not paying a price, you know, back somewhere down the supply chain for the products that we're using, and that's a really great example of that.
Yeah, in the connection between the environmental impacts in that community on their lives and on society.
Yeah, it is really a human rights issue, you know, when you look at it like that.
Yeah, and the two are so entwined.
Absolutely.
So I'm almost dreading asking this question. What's your biggest concern about the fashion industry at the moment?
I think my biggest concern isn't actually about the industry itself. It's more about consumers. So I think that, you know, when I talk to brands, they often say, you know, we would be willing to pay workers more or whatnot, but consumers aren't ready to pay more for clothing. And I think the biggest challenge for us going forward in improving the sustainability and the ethicalness of brands is actually getting consumers to follow through on the values that they hold as people. You know, if you value the environment, if you value people, then make sure that you are shopping from brands that really take those things into consideration. And that probably means you're going to be buying more expensive clothing and buying less clothing. But I guess, you know, and I'm part of this myself, like, there's a generation of people who've been completely sort of designed as these consumers, these mass consumers of clothing, and changing that is huge, but that's what needs to happen. And I think that's sort of, the biggest risk at the moment is that doesn't happen and we don't see more change.
So it's not, while there's a certain level of awareness of the impacts on the lives of the people that are producing our clothes, there's sort of a disconnect when people go to stores to purchase. It's not reflected in their behaviour.
That's right, and we need to understand how our purchasing habits here have direct impacts here and start, like, meshing the two together.
So when it comes to your personal choice in clothing, how do you approach it? Are you lean lifestyle, vintage? Mix it all up?
I definitely have been on a journey in this space. I would have been your classic sort of buy loads of clothes, throw them out, that sort of consumer. But obviously because I do this work, I have to practice what I preach. So I've kind of gone on that journey. And for me, I think I've moved more to sort of consuming less, so buying less clothes, buying pieces that I will wear for years, as opposed to just a year. Buying less and just throwing out less, you know, because if you buy less, you kind of like go, your turnover is a lot lower. The challenge for me is I feel like I'm at this point now where I have resisted, getting better at resisting the temptation to shop. If I do have the temptation to shop, I'll often go to an op shop. If I need to just do an impulse buy, I'll just go to an op shop.
Yeah.
Because in my mind, that's a little bit better. But I'm sort of at the point where my conviction is getting deeper, and I think going forward, I'll definitely be making more of an effort to buy from truly ethical brands. So not necessarily your mainstream brands that, you know, are doing well, but ones that really have built ethical practices into their business model, and that's how they work.
Right, so it's really in the DNA.
Yeah, but the challenge in that is fitting your personal style into, you know, those, because the ethical brands have a lot of them have a real particular aesthetic, and that's not my aesthetic. So for me, finding those brands where I can actually shop from that still makes me feel like me is actually quite a challenge.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh, I hadn't thought about that.
Yeah.
So, to finish on a positive note, what's really giving you hope about the industry at the moment?
I think in the space that I'm in, so talking to New Zealand headquartered brands, I think we are seeing an increase in the number of brands whose board or whose leadership actually understand the importance of having a transparent supply chain, of upholding the rights of workers and for caring for the environment. And so instead of it just being, you know, a passionate sustainability manager or ethical sourcing officer, it's actually sort of pressure coming from the top as well to improve the supply chain. And I think that's where we'll see real change. And I'm looking forward to our report coming out in April to see, you know, those brands, have they taken a jump because of that change in leadership? And also sort of looking forward to seeing that in a long-term space as well.
So that your report comes out April 2018.
Yeah.
Can people sign up to receive that report? Where would they go if they want to do that?
Yeah, they can go to our website, so tfr.org.nz/ethical fashion, and we can grab your details from there.
Brilliant. Hey, thank you, Claire.
Thanks so much.